Welcome to BBC What's New. Now, it was the story that had people across the world gripped. After spending more than 2 weeks trapped deep underground in a flooded cave in Thailand, 12 boys and their football coach were finally rescued.
As they arrived at hospital, crowds gathered to celebrate their safe return. One of the divers involved in the mission described it as the day hope became reality. Another said that to some, it had seemed impossible.
We accomplished a mission that was deemed by many as impossible. It was the first time in the world. It is a pride of Team Thailand. It was a mission made possible by Team Thailand. I want this success to be a model that can be replicated all over the country.
Certainly something to be proud of, but how did they get trapped in the first place?
Well, just over 2 weeks ago, the football team, who are called the Wild Boars, were with their coach in northern Thailand, exploring this underground cave. They entered the cave here, and while they were all inside it, suddenly it started to rain heavily outside.
Rainwater flooded in, blocking the entrance to the cave. The boys then had to go deeper inside the cave to find a high ledge to stay safe and above the rising water level.
The rescue mission was extremely dangerous and very difficult. So, how did they do it? Let's take a look.
These narrow flooded tunnels were the only way out. The boys were stuck over 800 meters below the ground. Their way out was 4 kilometers long, which took them around 4 hours. It included several sections underwater where diving was the only option. An international team of 18 diving experts got the boys out after they had medical checks. They were both attached to each boy, and the leading diver was carrying his oxygen tank for him. But there were some pinch points as small as 38 centimeters wide, where each one of them had to squeeze through individually. It was during this dangerous operation that former Thai Navy SEAL Saman Kunan died due to a lack of air.
Well, doctors are taking good care of all of the boys, but they haven't been able to go home just yet.
That's because there's a lot of ways their bodies have been affected by being stuck underground for so long. Doctors say that recovering from lack of light for 2 weeks could be one of the biggest challenges they'll face.
Because the boys have been in complete darkness for so long, their eyes are very sensitive. That means they have to wear sunglasses, or the sunlight could damage the retinas of their eyes.
Doctors are also looking closely at their lungs. That's because poor air quality in caves can cause diseases.
Now, you might think that these boys would be very hungry after not eating properly for so long, but it's very dangerous for them to eat too much too quickly right now. In fact, it could give them a heart attack. So they have to eat soft food that's very easy to digest.
Doctors are also checking their skin carefully because you're more likely to get fungal infections if you're stuck in a dark and wet environment.
And it's not just the physical problems that experts will be looking out for. Psychologists say that going through such a difficult experience could mean that the boys might suffer from anxiety or depression, or even a long-term fear of the dark.
Well, we've seen just how difficult the rescue mission was to get the boys out. One of the people involved in the operation was Danish diving instructor Ivan Karadzic. This is what he had to say about just how tough it was.
Getting forced to do something that no kid has ever done before. It is not in any way normal for kids to do cave diving at age 11. They're diving in something that is considered extremely hazardous environment, in zero visibility. The only light that's in there is the torches and lights we bring yourself. So I cannot understand how cool these small kids are, you know, and thinking about they being kept in a small cave for 2 weeks. They haven't seen their mom. Incredibly strong kids. Unbelievable, almost.
One of the boys, whose nickname Knight, missed his 16th birthday celebrations. That was during the 2 weeks that the team was stuck inside the cave.
But celebrations of a different kind have been happening outside the hospital, where he and his teammates have been treated. Hundreds of children gather to sing and cheer on the rescue team who got the boys out.
And the boys' classmates have some special messages for their friends.
When Knight comes back to school, we're giving him his birthday cake and some gifts we made for him. We're also singing a special song for him.
I want to give him a hug. I would often hang out at his house with him. I really want to see him and give him a hug.
I'm so happy. I was crying. I can't wait to see my friends and play football with them. I miss them.
Love that. Happy birthday to you, Knight.
Enjoy your celebrations, and it's great to see the whole team recovering well.
You know, Deb, sometimes I get major hair envy. Standing next to you with your afro is so nice.
Oh, I'm glad you like it. I love my hair too. I used to wear it in cornrows when I was younger, but now I like to leave it out.
Well, I'm really jealous. I wish I could grow an afro, but I don't think I could take care of it. But what about you? How do you like your hair? Yvette went to find out.
I would like to hope that when I grow up, I have enough confidence to wear my own hairstyle, like my natural hair out, and just feel pretty.
I would want a large afro, like this big.
Hair, hair, hair. From curls to twists, coils and braids, more and more people are celebrating the natural hair and turning away from chemical relaxers and hot combs. The movement towards natural hair has been growing for years. But it's not just about fashion. It's also about identity representation and ease.
I think a real representation is when I'm in my natural state with my poofy hair.
I feel like having natural hair, you can choose whatever style you want. And I kind of feel like it does represent who I am.
If you have your natural hair, you don't have any stresses.
The perception that long, straight hair equals better hair is still a norm. So how comfortable are you with your own natural hair out?
We get judged a lot. Oh, you have nappy hair, or, you know, it's not the trend, or, oh, this is not really the style, so you're kind of ugly.
All my friends have, like, extensions or, like, always wear their hair in braids or something like that. And, like, I'm the only one out of, I think, the whole entire fifth grade that has hair like this. And everybody loves touching my hair. It's like getting a free massage.
Africa has been called the mobile continent as millions embrace new technology, using it to communicate, express, and inspire themselves. Celebrity culture is also playing a part with films like Black Panther promoting a wave of hair icons and driving up demand for products to maintain natural hair.
The black hair industry is a multi-billion dollar business around the world. By some estimates, it's worth $6 billion in Africa alone.
But products for natural hair are often more expensive. So how do you look after your hair without spending a fortune?
Well, because I have a lot of avocados at my house, and I have water and I have oil, I put the avocado and mash up, then add the water and oil last, mix it together, then put it in my hair. I leave it for about 5-10 minutes, and I put a plastic bag, and then after that, I go and shower, I wash out, and that's it, really.
But while hair is big business, it's also very personal. And how you style your hair is up to you.
Awesome stuff. So what's your favorite hairstyle? We always want to hear from you.
Whether it's what you think about something you've seen on the show, or you have a brilliant story of your own,
send us an email to whatsnew@bbc.co.uk.
My name is DJ Switch, and you're watching BBC What's New.
If you were sat next to your biggest idol right now, what questions would you ask them? Maybe how did they become successful, or what's their favourite TV show?
Well, obviously, the answer to that would be BBC What's New.
Blatantly. So we asked you to send in your questions for John Dumelo, one of Africa's most famous actors. John, over to you.
Hi, I'm John Dumelo.
Hello, my name is Esther, and my question is, how long have you been in the movie industry?
Hi, Esther. I started filming in 1991, so if you do the math, that should be about 26, 27 years.
Hello,
viewers out there. My name is Comfort. I would like to know how you feel when acting.
Comfort. I feel comforted when I'm acting. The thing about acting is if you want to get it right, you have to put yourself in the mood and just be natural as possible. Once you do that, everything will be comfortable.
Hi, my name is Philip, and my favorite sport is swimming. So I want to know what your favorite sport is.
Hi, Philip. My favorite sport used to be basketball till I became fat. But I'm trying to get back to playing basketball, you know, because they claim I'm tall, so I can easily dunk.
Hello, I'm Precious. My question is, did you complete your school before going to the movie industry?
Yes, Precious, I did. I completed school before I went into the movie industry. The truth is that education is very important because education teaches you certain things that you might find it difficult to learn later on in life.
Hello, my name is Joel, and I want to ask, how many days did it take you to read your script during acting?
I am more of a last-minute person, so before I get on set, I read through the scenes, but I would say like an hour before my scene, that is when I actually learn the lines.
Hello, my name is Darren. I want to ask, in movies, when you treat people poorly, how do you feel?
It does affect me sometimes when I'm doing that, or maybe when I have to maybe hit somebody in a movie, it really affects me. So yeah, so it's been amazing answering your questions. The questions were beautiful, intelligent. You guys are smart. My name is John Dumelo. Keep on watching. Peace.
Thanks, John. Still to come on BBC What's New.
Now, is he the best dressed man in Africa? We go to Kenya to get some fashion tips.
Stay with us here on BBC What's New. Welcome back to BBC What's New. So, last week, Deb, you went to meet some Africans who were honoured by the Queen. This week, you've met Prince Harry. Where is my invite, please?
Sorry, Ben, but I actually didn't get to meet Prince Harry. Prince Harry and Meghan Markle met 120 young people from around the world to share their ideas for the future of the Commonwealth.
It was Prince Harry's first event as Commonwealth Youth Ambassador, and he said his priority is to hear what young people like you think.
Well, we're going to be hearing from them too, but first, let's look at what the Commonwealth is. What is the Commonwealth? It's made up of 53 countries, and 19 of them are in Africa. They work together as friends to improve the lives of their citizens and promote peace. Many used to be part of the British Empire, and Queen Elizabeth II remains their head. Some people have questioned whether there's any point to the Commonwealth, but others say it helps countries work together on important issues like education and the environment. Every 4 years, athletes compete in the Commonwealth Games. Next year, the Commonwealth will be 70 years old. Now, although the Commonwealth is pretty old, 60% of people living in the Commonwealth countries are under the age of 30. And that's why the organisation wants young people to get involved. So I went along to meet some of them. We're here because Prince Harry was recently made the Commonwealth Youth Ambassador. And we're going to talk to some of the young people he's been meeting.
My name is Tijani Christian, and I'm from the beautiful island of Jamaica.
My name is Solomon Udochi, and I'm from Nigeria.
My name is Ejinga Kankinza. I am on the doctorate in clinical psychology.
My name is Achaleke Christian Leke. I'm from the Republic of Cameroon.
In Cameroon, we are currently focused on working with young people in prisons who have a history of violence, and we are providing them an alternative to violence by providing them skills, mental health issues, sports, and many others. And we have branded them to what we call prisonpreneurs. And for example, the design I have on me, it's an outcome from the prisons, and they are doing an amazing job.
The refugees that I help, they actually come from different countries of the world. So at the moment, I'm actually mentoring a young refugee who is 16 years old from Afghanistan. And it's so nice. It's an opportunity to help these people settle well and obviously impact the community even better.
Hi,
The advantages of the Commonwealth to a young person are really vast. There are so many opportunities for so many different things and in different fields.
It was very wonderful to be here today, honestly, and not just for the opportunity to meet the Duke and the Duchess of Sussex, but also the opportunity to meet young minds from all over the Commonwealth. I've met new friends and I'm sure I'm going home very fulfilled.
We do understand that Commonwealth does have a colonial past and it cannot be, overlooked and it has to be addressed. But one thing I've learned about the past is that the past should inform us, but never inhibit us. Then we are in a better space to shape the future of the Commonwealth.
Well, I think we are in an era where we need to stop the blame game. We need to focus on making things work and making things change. There's no perfect institution. It's about seeing what has been done. Commonwealth is one of the highest organizations in the world that engages young people, and we are seeing life being changed at the grassroots level.
Boxing, that's just for guys, right?
Wrong! Well, in a poor part of Lagos in Nigeria, teenage girls are stepping into the ring to beat up stereotypes and punch their way out of poverty.
One of them is 16-year-old Cynthia, and she has big dreams.
People normally look at me as if this girl doing boxing. Where did she even, which time did she start, which time did they even give birth to her? They are thinking of so many things that this thinking girl can even do boxing. They normally say many things about me that they don't even, but now they are saying that there is good thing is already happening. Even though my equipment is not good, whatever, I'm always happy. My training is not easy. But if you focus on it and you have the determination, I'm going to put end to do anything. I would like to represent Nigeria in the next Olympic 2020. I want to be the champion. It feels so good to be a female boxer. Nothing man can do, no man cannot do.
Ben, have you ever had this kind of music?
I haven't. What is it?
It's called Gnawa. It's a traditional type of music in Morocco, which was brought over by sub-Saharan Africans way back in the 11th century.
I don't even know how to dance this, so I think we need to get some tips. Nora has been to meet the Gnawan master, Simo.
Meet Simo Lagnawi. He's a Gnawa musician from Morocco and he loves cats and lamb tagine.
Wait, stop! You're thinking what's Gnawa music, right? Well, let me tell you.
Gnawa music originates from sub-Saharan Africans who came to Morocco as slaves at the beginning of the 11th century. And since then, the music has become a fusion of sub-Saharan and North African beats and songs, which, according to Simo, symbolizes the diversity of the continent.
Gnawa music is strong spiritual music. It's coming from Morocco, Africa, bringing lots of vibes and creations and sunshines and lots of different things to us, one love.
What inspired you to become a Gnawa musician?
The Gnawa music is in our blood, yeah? It's in our blood and we get it from like a lot of old masters and big masters are what they playing this music, Gnawa music.
Yeah.
three instruments in Gnawa music: a big drum made of wood and goat's skins, and we have the gembri. He's made of camel skin and goat's gut, and half three sounds like original bass. And we have number three, the crackers metallic, what is coming straight with the gembri. And they are loud. Most of people, they love these instruments.
So Simo, with all this talk of beats and rhythm, you need to show me how to dance to Gnawa music.
Easy. Well, thanks, you need to have this hat.
Okay.
With it. Yeah, and your head, like that.
Nice, it matches my jeans.
Yes.
Perfect.
And we have to take our crackers ready for the dance. Yeah, and we go for number four times, and this is one, and we come back. We are to move our body like that, and this one is gonna give us straight word rhythm and our cracker.
You're obviously into fashion.
Oh yes, you know I like to dress well, Deb.
Yeah, well, you dress all right, but I don't know if you can beat this man.
Ooh, interesting. Well, he says he's a fashion icon. In fact, he thinks he's the best dressed man in the whole of Africa. We need to take a look.
I own about 160 suits. I have got more than 300 caps. I have got more than 200 pair of shoes. I'm Mr. James Mwangi. I come from Nairobi, Kenya, and I'm the smartest man, I think, in Africa or in the world. When I want to wear something, if it is a green suit, I wear with green shoes, green shirt, green cap, green handkerchief, green innerwear, green pen, and a green cover of my phone. When I come to Nairobi, I was wearing one shirt, and then many people are laughing at me because they know my father was a freedom fighter and he was poor. And that is when I asked God to give me something different to the other people. You have to ask God three things to be like whom I am today: taste, choice, and wisdom.
Okay, hear mommy.
I still think with the colors, he's doing much better than you are.
That's all from us this week, but do drop by our YouTube page if you want more from the What's New team during the week.
Just go to YouTube and search for BBC Africa What's New. And don't forget to hit the subscribe button to keep up to date with all our latest interviews and stories.
That's all for now, but see you next week.
Bye.